Good morning. Welcome to TCC. Welcome to our online service. It's been several weeks now since we haven't been able to meet in our physical location, but we've been able to meet in this way on our Facebook page, YouTube, on our website, in loads of different ways. We know that many of you have been connecting in different ways too. A little bit later on in this service, I'll share some ways that you can still connect with us or make a connection if you haven't yet done that. But I believe that in the midst of these kind of strange, difficult times, that there's also an opportunity for us to experience God in a way that we perhaps haven't before. I mean, on a very basic level, for some of us, that might simply be that we're enjoying church this morning while still in our pyjamas. It might be that we're able to sit on our sofa or on our favourite armchair and join in with worship this morning. Perhaps a way that we didn't see ourselves going to church several months ago. But yet here we are. And I believe that in the midst of this, these strange times, that there's an opportunity for us to meet with the living God in a new way, to meet with God afresh. And so that's going to be my prayer this morning. But just before we pray, just want to share what's going to take place in our service today. We're going to have a time of worship together. During that time, encourage you just worship as you feel free to do so. The Bible says that we should worship in spirit and truth. So I want to encourage you just to feel free to stay sitting on that favourite armchair of yours, to put your hand up while you're sitting on the sofa, or if you want, stand, jump around, dance, get the kids involved, do whatever it is that you feel free to do this morning. There's nobody watching you other than your family, so feel free to worship God this morning freely in your home. And then we're going to have the word from Dave Pickett, our senior minister. So make sure you have your Bible ready, a notepad perhaps ready to take some notes, maybe make a note of anything that just strikes you or sticks out to you. Feel free to comment below as well. If Dave says anything that really resonates with you, feel free to just make a comment in the comment section below. It'd be great to hear from you in the ways that you're engaging and being inspired by our service this morning. But as I say, in the midst of these strange times, in the midst of this opportunity, let's just pray that God would meet with us in a new amazing way this morning. So Father God, I thank you this morning that we're able to meet together. Lord, I thank you that we're able to meet with you in our own homes in this way this morning. And Lord, whether we're sitting down, standing up in our favourite armchair or tucked away in a little corner, Lord, I just pray that you would meet with us afresh, every single one of us. And Lord, I recognise that for some people in this service today, Lord, it might be the very first time that they're encountering you, that they're meeting with you, Lord. I pray, Lord, that they would know that you are with them during this time. But Lord, for some of us who have maybe encountered you or had experiences with you many, many times, Lord, I pray this morning that we would meet with you afresh. We would meet with you in a new, exciting, inspiring, challenging way. So Lord, be with us in this service, we pray in your name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to hand over to our worship leader as we enter our time of worship now.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Oh, you will lay down your life that I will be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. sing, who brings our chaos? Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shine like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfading love. It's you who take my place. It's you who bear my cross. Oh, you will lay down your life, and I will be set free. Yeah. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, that you've done for me, Lord. Thank you for all you've done. Sing, worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Sing worthy. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. It's you who take my place. It's you who bear my cross. Oh, you will lay down your life, that I will be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Sing, this is amazing grace. This is amazing grace. This is unfading love. You would take my place. It's you and bear my cross. Oh, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Done for me. Thank you. Yes, Lord God, we thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you that in these uncertain times, that you're with us, that you haven't left us, you haven't forsaken us like you promised. We just want to declare this morning that you are worthy, Lord. You are worthy. We want to give you our praise. We want to give you all our worship. We ask that your Holy Spirit just move in our homes now. Holy Spirit, come. want to see your face. Lord, we want to hear your voice. Holy Spirit, come. Amen. This is my prayer in the desert, when all that's within me feels dry. This is my prayer in the hunger and need. My God is the God who provides. Oh, this is my prayer in the fire, in weakness or trial or pain. There is a faith proved I'm more worth than gold. So refine me, Lord, through the flame. I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare. God is my victory and he is here. This is my prayer in the battle, and triumph is still on its way. I am a conqueror and co-heir with Christ, so firm on the promise I'm living. I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and he is here. You are here, Lord, you are with. Season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. Oh, I have a reason to worship. Sing this out, all of my life. All of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason worship. May this be your declaration this morning, church. All of my life, in every season, you ask of God, I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. All of my life, all of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. I will bring praise. I will bring praise. I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice. I will declare, God is my victory and he is here. I will bring my praise, Lord. I will bring my worship. I choose to worship. Oh, I choose to worship you, Lord. I will bring praise, no weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here. Beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High, hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is! What a beautiful name it is! The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great and life was greater. Oh, I could separate us now. What a wonderful name it is. Wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Oh, what a wonderful name, the name we praise, the name we worship, Jesus. Oh, we lift up our praise. Oh, death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, the silence, the boast of sin and fear. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. Oh, you have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. Come on, church, let's declare this. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Oh, yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. You have no rival, you have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. Lord, in that song it speaks of nothing being able to stand against the name of Jesus. And Lord, we want to apply that to the times that we're in at the moment, Lord, where there's fear and worry and anxiety and all these different things that we're having to face, having to deal with. Lord, you've won against all those things. Jesus, you have the victory. So Lord God, wherever we're at this morning, whether we're in a good place or whether we're just feeling the weight of our circumstances and the situation that we're in, Lord, I thank you that you remind us that you've won, that we can trust you, you are faithful, that you are victorious. Praise you, Jesus. We praise you, we thank you. Jesus. Amen.
How uplifting and encouraging is it to be able to worship God in our own homes, knowing that our church family is gathered together to do the same? I find it so uplifting and encouraging, and I hope that you do too. I just want to share a few kind of notices with you to make sure that you know some of the things that are going on, especially with everything being different and new during this time. So firstly, we have an e-newsletter that gets sent out. If you have been receiving that, then great. Hope you're able to read that and pick up on the things in there. If you haven't been receiving that and you would like to, then you can send an email to office@thebeacon.org. And just let them know that you'd like to receive the newsletter, and now make sure that you're added to that mailing list as well. There's different ways that you can connect with the church. You can subscribe to our YouTube page. You can also follow our Facebook page that we're on now. You can find us on our website, www.thebeacon.org, where there's lots of different content available on there. But as well, during this period, our life groups are still meeting together, many of them over video kind of conferencing apps like Zoom and Google Hangouts. And I want to encourage you that if you've maybe thought about joining life group in the past and you just haven't ever gotten around to doing so, or you just feel that during this period that would be something that's really beneficial to you, then do please let us know. Again, you can email office@thebeacon.org and we'll point you in the right direction and connect you with one of our groups so that you can feel more connected in that way too. If you haven't picked up, we're now going to do a regular communion slot at 9 o'clock every Sunday morning. That's going to be over Facebook Live. There'll be one of the ministers or one of the team here at the church will be leading that. Want to encourage you to join with that. Grab some bread, some red juice, and just prepare to take communion with us at 9 o'clock every Sunday morning. If you're not on Facebook and you're watching this on YouTube or the website, then there'll also be a recorded version of communion you can use at any time, but especially if you want to know that you're joining with others, you can use that at 9 o'clock on a Sunday morning as well. And then just lastly, something that we shared on our Facebook page this week was a video about financial giving. And we're not sharing this information or this kind of news item to ask for your money per se, but we just want to make sure that you're aware of the different ways that you're able to give, especially as we're not able to meet physically together as we normally would, taking up a physical offering. And so if you would normally gave your offering via cash in the offering that came round on a Sunday, or you give through the envelope system, then we're just asking if you would be able to change your giving to online giving during this time. So either setting up a standing order or by making bank transfers during this period. Then that would just be really helpful for us to maintain the regular income that we have to be able to still do the things that we want to do during this period and beyond. And so we'd be really grateful if you're able to do that. We appreciate that for many, this situation has impacted your finances, and we want you to know that that's okay. Don't feel guilty if your giving has to go down. Your giving is ultimately between you and God, and he's aware of the circumstance, and ultimately he will provide for your needs and he will provide for ours. And so if your giving has to go down, then that's okay. Don't feel guilty about that. But if you are able to make that change to online giving during this time, that would be really appreciated too. Now it's time to hear from the Word. I hope you've got your Bibles ready, your notepads ready to take notes too. And I'm going to hand over to Dave Pickett, our senior minister.
Good morning, folks, and welcome to the third sermon in our second part of our longer series looking at the book of Ephesians. And today we're going to be looking at Paul's teaching on knowing Christ-like living. Paul reminds us that we are called to live like Christ. That means that when people look at our lives, what they should see is a resemblance to Jesus. Not in our appearance. Imagine if we all had to grow beards and wear our hair long. The ladies would have trouble with the beards, and at least some of the men would have trouble with the hair. Mind you, I think my hair is getting a bit Davy Crockett hat-like at the moment. Rather than my normal short cut, it's getting a bit long. I'll be wearing a ponytail soon, like Davy Crockett's coonskin cap. What Paul means is that the life we live reflects the inner strengths and values of Jesus. And his argument is this is only achievable with the presence of the Holy Spirit. I guess Paul is saying, listen, these values are so good that it's impossible for mere humans to be able to develop them with enough power to live them without the presence of the Holy Spirit and the empowering presence at that. Let's look at the scripture together. You can use your own Bibles or read it from the screen, or you can simply listen. The reading is from Ephesians chapter 4, 17 to chapter 5, verse 20. It was quite a long reading, and I'll read it to you. So I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that's in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they've been given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught, with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be God-like in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbour, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. And get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. But among you there must not even be a hint of sexual immorality, or of any kind of impurity or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. For of this you can be sure, no immoral, impure or greedy person, such a person is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such thing God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. Therefore, do not be partners with them. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes a light. This is why it said, "Wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord. Always give thanks to God the Father for everything, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's pray. Father, as ever, we recognize that these words make little sense without the presence of your Holy Spirit bringing these words to life. The Bible says that your word is living and active. So, Lord, send your Spirit to make your words living, and let them live in us, active in our values and identities, so that we may truly know what it is, not as a theory to live Christ-like lives, but to know what it is to truly live like Christ, with his values on display and his kingdom on display in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. I think the first point that Paul is making is to do with the hardness of people's hearts. And the first thing about that I notice is that Paul separates the world into two categories, the Christian believer and the Gentile. The word Gentiles simply means nations. Jews saw themselves as a nation united by genealogy, or by blood, with a faith that was defined by their adherence to the law. Paul sees Christians as united by relationship with Jesus and empowered by the presence of the Holy Spirit in their lives, and defined not by adherence to law, but by the grace of God. There's something quite remarkable too about the context of this letter, which would help Paul to separate the Christian believers from the nations. Because Ephesus was part of the Greek Empire, and it was once considered to be the most important city in the Greek Empire. It's an ancient port city in modern Turkey, so it's placed between Europe and Asia. This means that it was quite literally full of the nations. And those people from all the different nations of the known world brought their culture, their cultural values, their idols, and their mode of worship with them to the city. And the Greek goddess Artemis was the goddess of Ephesus. And the statues of Artemis are actually quite obscene. They are covered with lumps, and for years some people thought that they were the form of female breasts or the form of tumours. But actually, modern archaeologists have realised that because of the absence of nipples on the breasts, they're actually representing bull's testicles, which is foul, isn't it? Imagine a god that was covered with those things. Well, that's what Artemis was. Because Artemis was the goddess whose worship included licentiousness and debauchery, temple prostitution, and was completely offensive to God. But the people that wanted to indulge in their own perversions, of course, worshipped the god Artemis, because her perversions gave them permission to indulge in their perversions. And when people indulge in those perversions, I think that God recognizes that the biggest perversion of all is the fact that they pervert love, tenderness, personal commitment, family, and replace all of that with self-indulgence. So in these verses, by categorizing people as Christian on the one hand and other nations or Gentiles on the other, Paul is trying to make a clear distinction. But it does seem a bit harsh, doesn't it? It seems to suggest that all of these non-Christians were scoundrels. Look, let's be honest, how many of your non-Christian friends would you describe as indulging in every impurity or full of greed? And one of the difficulties of reading the Bible, and verses like this in particular, is that we sometimes have trouble getting our minds out of our culture and into the setting in which they were first written. Back in Paul's day, there was good reason why Jews and Gentiles would never hang out together and would remain quite separate as much as they possibly could. It's because they were worlds apart, and their inner values, the things that characterized them, were completely different. And the Jews would look down upon the Gentile as an immoral sinner from their lofty religious legalistic perches, while the Gentile would look down on the Jew as a stuck-up religious prude. While we may worry about a downhill slide of morals in our day, the morality of the New Testament times, in places like Ephesus in particular, was very much worse. It's quite wrong to think that their culture is comparable to ours, and that people could be freely independent of the practices that were going on all around them, because quite simply, that was their culture. But hang on, let's look at our culture for a moment. I'm sure that Paul knew that there are good people, but he also knew that not all people are good. There are lots of people out there who are kind, lovely, gentle, good, loving, and even sacrificial. But these people are individuals, generally speaking, that do not represent the values and the culture of the world that we live in. During this coronavirus, we've heard MPs talking about praying for one another. And I know just a small handful of MPs who are Christians. But when they get into the house, they try their best to influence the culture of our land. But listen, you and I both know that the culture of the land is set by people that we actually don't know. So what are the values of the world? Well, for example, did you know that there's been an attempt to liberalize the laws surrounding abortion in this country during the COVID-19 shutdown? They didn't get through, but they may still be reintroduced. In New Zealand, new laws were passed, which means that now New Zealand has the most extreme abortion law in the world. This will include abortion available on demand for any reason up to birth. And the definition of birth is quite horrendous too. Sex selective abortion will be legalized. In other words, if you find out that the baby inside you is a boy and you wanted a girl, or a girl and you wanted a boy, that is reason enough for the abortion to take place. There are several other points of law in the old law that many consider to be protection for the mother and the child, but they've all been swept away by this new legislation. Shockingly, opinion polls show that the new law is strongly opposed by the public in New Zealand, and in particular by women, with only 2% of women supporting abortion being available on demand up to birth, 93% of women opposing sex-selective abortion being legal, and 94% of women supporting the current legal standards for abortion providers and premises. So that decision does not reflect the heartfelt values of individual people of the nation. But somehow the law got through, even in a country that calls itself a democracy. It's been suggested that these discussions were timed to take place under the shadow of the lockdown, when people are distracted by the pandemic. What is the value and the culture of the nation being displayed here? Now, I want to just jump in here for a moment and say, look, there are many people, even in our church, that have had an abortion. I want to tell you that I do not judge people that have had an abortion. My heart breaks for the child that was lost. But I don't judge you if you had an abortion. It makes me sad. And I don't believe that God will condemn you for having an abortion either. I think what God's response to that would be is to call you to his side, to call you to his kingdom, to call you in repentance, so that you can be completely forgiven and restored to him. But this thing I do know is that women that go through abortion carry the guilt and pain of that abortion for the rest of their lives. And God wants you to be free even of that pain, and to be able to rejoice in the forgiveness that only he can offer you. So by highlighting abortion, I am not being judgmental. I'm just trying to highlight the values of a nation being different from the values of individuals within the nation. And there are other examples too. The sex education of children in this country is an ongoing issue. Teachers don't like it. Lots of parents don't like it. But somewhere protected in the darkness of anonymity, there are adults deciding to liberalize these things to your children. Why do we not know about these things until they happen? Transsexuals reading stories about gender fluidity to very young children. These things do not represent us. They do not even represent the homosexual community, who are also, by and large, outraged by this. But they are done in secret, hidden away, with no public knowledge, let alone public debate. And when these things happen, they harden the heart of a nation, of a culture, and then of individuals. When Paul looks into the collective human heart, he sees hardness, a no longer caring attitude, a looking the other way, a looking after oneself. Paul says, listen, that's not good enough for a Christian. We are not to be worldlike, we are to be Christlike. And so he begins with his analysis of the human heart and the darkness and ignorance and corruption and the futility of the heart of our culture. And his argument is based on the importance that the root of our problem be recognized and therefore dealt with. There's no point in going on in this text and telling people how to manage their anger, chapter 4, verse 26, and their money, chapter 4, verse 28, and their sexuality, chapter 5, verse 3, and their time, chapter 5, verse 16, and of course their tongue, chapter 4, verse 29. If you don't help people to know and heal the disease that turns all these things into futility. If we want to escape from futility in our daily lives, we have to first of all take a long, hard look within ourselves. We cannot settle for quick fixes and superficiality. We cannot settle for even superficial attitude changes. We want to be healed. We want to be free from the very root of futility. Otherwise, we might even find ourselves drawn to sit on that religious perch, looking down on people and judging them, even for things like abortion. So in chapter 4, verses 17 to 19, we get what is effectively a heart surgeon's report on the state of the human heart. It is hard. His second point is the result of the hard heart. And he says that the hard heart leads to ignorance, and ignorance leads to alienation from God. We feel a separation from him. Even when Christians get into this situation, when we pray, we feel that our prayers are shallow and self-centered. We feel guilty because we recognize that it's turned into some kind of cut price shopping list. And when we hear of these things in Parliament being changed, we feel powerless. And we turn away rather than shouting our objections or at least writing to our MP and our Prime Minister. So rather, instead of being conformed by fear of exposure and rejection for having outdated views or fear of being condemned as a prude when you know that you're not, we should rather refuse to follow society's lead and instead follow God's leading and be more Christ-like. Remember how Jesus took on the community leaders of his day, the scribes and the Pharisees, the Roman governor. Remember how he passionately challenged them, yet he did not break the law. Of course, his views were unpopular, and they undeniably got him in trouble. But he changed the world. Therefore, we would do well to hear Paul's voice and to realize that he doesn't ask us to change the world. He calls us to start with ourselves, to look into our hearts and seek healing there. So I will end this short sermon with a reminder of Paul's conclusion. He compares the fruitless anti-life philosophy and values of the world as darkness with the life-giving values of the Christianity empowered by the Holy Spirit as light. And he says this directly to us, "For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them." And he goes on to say, "Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another with psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Just imagine if you were surrounded by the lightness of knowing that everybody around you was honest. Everybody around you, their values meant that they consist in their attitudes and their lifestyle as goodness, righteousness, truth. Imagine the trust that you could have in other people, so that even when you have issues, imagine the trust if you knew that you could take them to people that are good and righteous and only ever deal in truth. That's what our church can be like. I believe that our church is like that in part, but we are yet to be fully 100% saturated in the Holy Spirit. Our desire is there. Let's continue to pursue it. Let's continue to find the culture of the church that is full of this, so that we are not conformed by the dark culture around us, but rather we are conformed to the likeness of Christ, and we can truly know what it is to live Christ-like lives and to live in a community where Christ-likeness is the currency of the community. Amen. Let me pray. Father, I do pray for these wonderful values to be expressed in our church, in our fellowship, and experienced in our lives. Help us, therefore, no matter what our context, to be able to live like this. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, God bless you, folks. I know that there will be people that live in various different contexts today. There are some of you that are alone. There are some of you that are in small communities, family units. But I just want to encourage you that God calls you to walk with him, so you're never truly alone because you have him with you, but also in community. So there will always be people available to you on the phone, through the life groups or the church offices, where you can find someone to talk to, someone that will show you goodness, righteousness, kindness, and truth and love. And be prepared to show all of those things to somebody who might need them from you. Amen. God bless you. I hope you have a really good week that is filled with goodness and righteousness and truth. Amen. God bless you.